I'm James Kibbe, chair of the University of Michigan Organ Department. Thank you for coming to this session of our 61st annual organ conference, Passions and Visions. This year we invited our faculty and our students and distinguished guest artists to present something they're passionate about as a way of envisioning the future of organ, harpsichord, carillon, and sacred music. The student recital at the organ conference is always a highlight for us. We are so proud of our students, and tonight is especially exciting. This is the first organ student recital for a live audience in 19 months here. This evening, five of our students are presenting a program in honor of our longtime organ technician, Jerry Adams, who just recently retired after 23 years of service to the organ department. Jerry's passion for the pipe organ and his vision for its future have been central to our students' success. I can tell you, Jerry has been an ideal colleague, invariably accommodating, positive, and kind. Jerry maintained all 15 pipe organs on campus, but a large part of his work and his love was lavished on the Fries Memorial Organ here in Hill Auditorium. The technologies in this organ range from the 1890s up to cutting-edge solid-state systems, and no one knows about it and understands it as much as Jerry does. I'd like to introduce now Richard Houghton, a longtime friend and business associate of Jerry's and a good friend of the organ department.
Hello. Oh my gosh, it's loud. I think this is supposed to be something like a roast. Don't worry. Some of us have been lucky enough to have stumbled upon something we love to do that became our life's work. Few knew what that work would be at an early age, but Gerald Adams was one of those lucky few and was greatly influenced by two gentlemen, Myron Kasner and Robert Nera. Raised in Sturgis, Michigan, in the southwest corner of the state, Jerry was fortunate to have been mentored during his high school years by Myron Kasner, with whom he studied music theory and organ. Mr. Kasner, who at that time was teaching at Sturgis High School, was an organist and composer who had studied at the Royal College of Music in London under Dr. Harold Drake and at Wesleyan University, Dr. Harold Dark, sorry. He had been organist at St. Michael's London, at St. Paul's Chestnut Hill, Christ Church Cathedral, St. Louis, and finally at St. John's Episcopal in Sturgis. In addition to his musical gifts, Myron Kasner was an accomplished woodworker and cabinet maker and was able to encourage Jerry in the practical aspects of organ building. Jerry recalls that Kasner once wrote a letter to his daughter on a long, paper-thin sheet of wood that he had planed from a pine board. It was fortunate that Mr. Kasner was on the high school staff because their guidance counselor hadn't a clue how to advise someone who wanted to be a pipe organ builder. Around that same time, Jerry was able to rent the woodworking shop of a neighbor who had passed away. In that shop, he built a slider wind chest using only hand tools and built a number of pipes, reservoirs, and wind chests for Robert Naren's early instruments. During high school, Jerry had also established himself as a piano tuner. One of his clients was a physician who had purchased a 9-foot Steinway for his son, who was thought to have a terminal illness. The son survived, lost interest in the piano, and his father sold it to Jerry, who had been saving money for years and years by cutting lawns and doing piano tunings. The Steinway is reputed to have been Rachmaninoff's touring piano. Robert Naren also greatly influenced Jerry's life. Having begun work part-time for Naren right out of high school, Jerry lived in a rooming house up on Broadway Hill, and commuted by bicycle to Naren's home in Barton Hills. At that time, chair of the organ department, Naren concertized extensively and had the largest discography of any organist of the time, numbering over 40 LPs. Now, the younger amongst you may not know what a long playing record is. If you just sort of think of it as a sort of a really big, black, not-so-floppy disc with grooves all around. I'm told that some of you have never even owned a CD. Naren was one of the first in Ann Arbor to own a VW Beetle, of which he and his wife Eloise were fiercely proud. While on a European tour, they graciously allowed Jerry the use of the car, the owner's manual for which was only in German. Because he couldn't figure out how to engage reverse gear, Jerry could only park in spaces that allowed a forward exit. While in Germany in 1958, Naren had sample flue pipes and voicing tools sent to Jerry, encouraging him to experiment with voicing. Later, he arranged for Jerry to visit several European organ builders, including Rieger in Austria and Beckeroth, where he spent time with Rudolf von Beckeroth at his Hamburg workshop. These were heady times for American organ building. The organ reform movement was taking hold, with Naren near the forefront. It was actually he who suggested to E. Power Biggs that he explore the old European instruments. He was influential in Beckeroth's obtaining his first U.S. contract in Cleveland, and Rieger's early tracker instruments, two of which were installed in this very building, a three-manual 30-rank up in Naren's studio, and a two-manual practice instrument of 23 ranks. Jerry worked in Naren's shop over the course of 10 years, assisting with or building about 17 instruments, part-time from 1957, and full-time from 1961. I met Naren by taking his organ design and construction class during my last year as a psych major, and later joined his workshop, then housed in the former West Side Dairy building on Brook Street on the west side of Ann Arbor, and that's where I met Jerry. Jerry first became acquainted with the Hill organ by carrying out specific tasks under Naren's direction. I first worked here in the summer of 1966 while assisting the organ technician, Melvin Light. So our mutual association with organ dates back some 62 years. Lord, that makes me feel old. It's true. When Mel Light's health was failing in 1977, Jerry was hired to assist. After Mel's passing, Sam Kuntz was appointed organ technician in 1982. 10 years later, Jerry succeeded Sam following his death in 1992 at age 34. This building and organ had been through a lot since 1913. Those of you who didn't know Hill Auditorium before the $40 million 20-month renovation of 2003 and 4 will have to imagine this entire building, this ceiling, all these facade pipes sprayed with gray paint that concealed everything, burying the original colorful decor and even hiding those lovely necklace lights that you see above you. The only dash of color remaining at that time was the M way up there in faded blue and tarnished gold, not even lighted as it is now. Jerry was responsible for safeguarding the organ during the building renovation. These 51 facade pipes were removed for restoration, and the arch was closed with plywood panels. A dedicated furnace and blower kept the organ at stable temperature and humidity while maintaining a positive pressure relative to the rest of the building in order to ensure the dust wouldn't get into the organ. Well, that was the theory, at least. When the protection was removed, Jerry discovered that a family of raccoons had taken up residence, their paw prints visible in the dust that wasn't supposed to be there. The unenclosed great pipework just behind the facade pipes here had been covered with plastic, and during the last frantic week before reopening, some tradesperson trampled the positive mixture, flattening it in both a literal and a tonal sense. Since then, under Jerry's supervision, the organ has been cleaned, re-leathered, the blower rebuilt, the console rebuilt with current technology. Because this building was always so heavily booked, and practice time always at a premium, tuning and maintenance generally took place well after midnight. Any of you who have ventured inside the organ know what a labyrinth of wind lines and wind chests, ladders, and walkboards it is. Not for the faint of heart. So now, with the majority of chapters on the left side of his book, it seemed time for Jerry to pass the tuning iron to others. I'm sure with gratitude for all the opportunities and friendships built over the last 28 years. Fini.
I'm grateful to our alumna, Sherry Brown, for helping to arrange the mementos that we're going to present this evening. So we'll get, I think, both Jerry and Dick to step up here.
No.
This is the part where you come up. So I'm going to hand you this, but it's heavy. So first of all, this is a crystal mantle clock that's engraved with Jerry's name and the dates of his service as organ technician. We chose a clock to represent all of the time that he's given for us. As Dick said, much of it, you know, late at night.
This would be an hourglass then, right?
Yeah, exactly. And then we have this wooden plaque that we're going to place permanently inside the organ chamber here at Hill. It has the block M at the top, organ department at the University of Michigan, in recognition of Gerald Adams, University Organ Technician, 1993 to 2021. So I'm going to hand you that too. Jerry, on behalf of me, people here, people around the world that you have benefited, thank you.